So we've evolved somewhat the style of Torah study here. It's a fascinating experience. And I'm evolving it a little bit to incorporate within the Torah study the fear, the Jewish approach to fear and anxiety. It is probably our greatest challenge right now. So I would like to address that issue. Just before I begin, I'd like to start off with a quick story. It says in the Talmud, Tractate Bava Kama, Folio 60, Side B, that in the case of a plague, when the plague, you're supposed to get out of town. Just go, get out. Which is fascinating that the Talmud knew the stuff, you know, thousands of years ago. Obviously, the rabbis of the Talmud were onto something which we're catching on today. The Talmud then goes on to say that if it's spread out everywhere, then there's nowhere to run. However, one of the commentaries, Ben Yehoyada, comments, and he says he was the chief rabbi of, I think he was the chief rabbi of Baghdad. I got to check him up. But anyways, he comments and he says that even, and that in the case of cholera, which is an interesting word in Hebrew, cholera is cholera. Cholera, which means very sick. Cholera in Hebrew is cholera, which is very sick, like a bad sickness. So in the case of cholera, says the Ben Yehoyada, even if it's spread out everywhere, you should still get out of town. Why? Hi, Alina. Good morning. Welcome. And hi, Ed. And Adrian. So why would you have to get out of town? Good morning, Dean. Happy birthday for yesterday. Why would you have to get out of town if cholera is what's spreading around? Says the Ben Yehoyada, because if you can't avoid the plague, at least you should avoid the fear and the panic. Fear and the panic is what you should be getting out of. And he explains that there was a story in the Medrash of a man who met the angel in charge of the plague. And the man asked the angel in charge of the plague, how many people are you going to take today? And the angel said, 5,000 people I'm going to take today. Terrible. By the end of the day, 15,000 people had died. Good morning, Michael. Welcome. 15,000 people had died. The man later bumps into the angel in charge of the plague, and he says to him, you lied to me because you said 5,000 people you were going to take today, and we lost 15,000 people today. The angel replied and he said, 5,000 was the ones that I was supposed to take. The other 10 were those that fell on their own through fear. Now I want you to digest that for a moment. The other 10 were those who fell on their own through fear. This notion of fear as a human emotion is actually our Achilles heel. According to Jewish spirituality, it is the number one enemy. It was said so beautifully by, was it FDR? Who said, we have nothing to fear but fear itself. Help me out here, folks. Hi, Shalom Ber Shmueling from Venice, Florida. Great to have you with us. Do comment, sir. My good friend, Rabbi Shalom Ber Shmueling, runs the Chabad of Venice in Florida. Amazing operation over there. Good friend of mine. He's from Switzerland. So I think it was FDR who said, we have nothing to fear but fear itself. And that is a very, very powerful concept, a very powerful emotion, a very powerful notion. And I want to remind you of something that happened to Moses. Do you remember when Moses killed the Egyptian who was attacking the Jew? That was one story in the Torah in Exodus in the beginning. The next day he sees a Jew attacking another Jew. And he says, why are you hurting your friend? And the man says, are you going to kill me like you killed the Egyptian yesterday? I'm going to slander you to Pharaoh. It says then that Moses was afraid. Vayira Moshe. Moses feared. Vayomar. He actually verbalized his fear. Vayomar. Achen noda hadavar. The matter is known. Thank you, Elaine and Ron. I see Elaine commenting on my phone. She says that it was FDR. Elaine and Ron are not Facebook people. So we got you, Elaine and Ron. Thank you. He said, Moses verbalizes his fear, and he said, behold, the matter is known, and you're afraid. Immediately after, the very next words are Vayishma Pao, and Pharaoh heard. The story continues. Pharaoh sends Moses, his adopted grandson. Remember, Pharaoh was raised by Batia, daughter of Pharaoh. How ironic. He was sent to the executioner, And as the executioner was trying to decapitate Moses, the Medrash tells us that Moses' neck turned to marble and he was able to miraculously escape. However, the message we learn is a fundamental principle in Jewish spirituality and meditation, that fear is the antithesis of faith. Where there is fear, there is no faith. Where there is faith, there is no fear. They're not all or nothing. Sometimes you can have 10% faith and 90% fear. You could be 60-40, or even 50-50. But I do believe, according to my understanding of how the Rebbe teaches the concept of fear and anxiety, that even 1% of fear is a lack of faith. It's like light and darkness. Where there is light, there's no darkness. Where there's darkness, there is no light. And if you are experiencing faith, you will have no fear. In a beautiful video that is going viral around the internet right now, there's a woman who comes by the Rebbe at Dollars, and she asks the Rebbe, who was giving out Dollars every Sunday. I see everybody's commenting here. Churchill, FDR. FDR. It still looks like Churchill plagiarized it. Thank you. Hi, Daniel Klein. Good morning from New York and Boca. So, a video that's going around the internet right now, this woman comes to the Rebbe and she says, I'm going to South Africa. Is it safe for me to go? I guess it must have been during the time of hijacking or there was crime going on, you know, cars being hijacked, a lot of people being, whatever. So the Rebbe says to her, don't be afraid. She says, okay, how am I not supposed to be afraid? The Rebbe gave a special lesson to South Africa, by the way. He said it's going to be good in South Africa until Mashiach comes and even better afterwards. So the lady asked the Rebbe, she says, how can I not have fear? So the Rebbe said, study the 13th century scholarly work, Duties of the Heart, Chayvos HaLevavos, specifically study the Gates of Trust. And this is this book. Duties of the Heart, Chayvos HaLevavos, by Rabbeinu Bachaye, who is, Rabbeinu Bachaye, that's his name, Rabbi Bachya ibn Pakta, written originally in Arabic. And this little beautiful book, I have to tell you, it changed my life. This book changed my life. It changed my entire perception of the world, of reality, my ability to take on fear and anxiety. And these days, for the past 18 years, I've been living with this, breathing this every single day. And I thought, what better time than ever, but to teach this to our community, to our global community, which is the Duties of the Heart, the Gates of Trust. This work is about 120 pages. We'll be going through it every morning for the next, for as long as this goes on, for as long as this coronavirus thing goes, because our belief is that fear is what brings us down, and faith, more specifically trust in God, is what banishes the fear and causes the positive outcome. In the words of the Rebbe, of the Chabad Rebbe's, Tracht gut, wird sein gut. When you think good, wird sein gut, then it will be good. When you trust in God, when you have good thoughts, not because you're just thinking positive thinking for the sake of positive thinking, but positive thinking because Almighty God is my Father, is your Father. Almighty God, the guy in charge of the problem, is also in charge of the solution, and therefore God will never abandon me. When you strengthen your resolve and strengthen your faith because of God Almighty, not because of the self-help section in Barnes & Noble, not because it's vogue and trendy to think positive thoughts, but you're thinking positive thoughts because God Almighty, Master of the Universe, is my guy, is on my side. Therefore, I know I have nothing to fear. It's that perception that causes the positive outcome. In a nutshell, when we trust blindly in God, measure for measure, God reciprocates in kind by blindly awarding us with a desired outcome. One more time, I'm going to say that. When you and I trust blindly in God, without calculating if God has the power to solve this crisis, my crisis, whatever your crisis is, when I trust blindly in God without calculating God's power, then God reciprocates in kind by granting me the desired outcome, again, without calculating whether I deserve it or not. So that's what the principle, the doctrine of trust in God is all about. The worst thing we can do right now, folks, is to be afraid. The worst thing we can do right now is to be afraid. This does not mean that you ignore the medical directives. Absolutely not. Please, folks, stay home, especially if you're older, if your immune systems are compromised. Don't go out. Stay home. Don't go out. Do what the doctors tell you. Do what the medical professionals tell you. Don't go to the bar. Don't go to a movie. Don't go to the beach. Just stay home, please. Our lives are precious and they cannot be played with. This is a very complex virus. Let the medical professionals work it out. Let's not overwhelm the hospital bed system. Let's make sure that we have, you know, that we're doing this properly. But at the same time, let us not be afraid, because the fear itself is what's going to take us down, God forbid, and trust. And trust in God is what's going to pick us up. So let's get straight into this. Where, if you do have the book, I'm starting on page 348, 349, which is actually section 4 of this book, Duties of the Heart, 13th century work by Rabbeinu Bachaye. It's the gates of trust in God, on placing one's trust in God alone. And this is what we're starting today. Okay? Any comments, questions, or critique, folks, please do comment. It's a pleasure to study with everybody here. And it's so amazing to be able to have our community together. Dvorah Hana says to me yesterday, she joined, just joined the group. Hi, Dvorah Hana, good morning. She wrote me such a beautiful text. I was so touched by it. She said, online, I hope it's okay. She said to me, the live learning is so great. I enjoyed listening today about this week's parasha. A lot, starting the day with you, Rabbi, and ending with Chana. So blessed. At this time when you would think social distancing would separate us, instead you're more connected than ever. I love that at-home learning. And that's a very beautiful message from Dvorah Hana. Thank you. I certainly feel so connected with our community, even as we are socially distanced, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. We are so much closer than ever, and so eloquently put there, Dvorah Hana. Thank you. So let's get straight to this with the gates of trust. I'm going to go through, going to discuss it, and hopefully build our trust in God. Having discussed in the preceding gate obligation, by the way, if you do happen to have the Chayenu app, if you know what that is, chayenu.org, I encourage you to go to chayenu.org, which is daily Torah study delivered to your door. If you do the Chayenu app, the gates of trust is inside of the app, and it also appears, I wish I could post something here. Let me just check if I can find the gates of trust. Share with you just very quickly. Maybe I can post a link. Maybe give me a quick second over here. I think I might have found something. This might be something. Okay, I think I found something here. I'm going to post it to our group in case you want to follow along. I'm going to post it in the comments right now. Gates of Trust. Just that you can follow along with something. Okay, good. All right, so yes, Michael said it changed his life. I can tell you, I learned from everybody that I recommend this book to. This book will change your life. It changed my life. When I was going through a crisis, I was 22 years old. I was in England. And I was attacked by a group of about 25 or 28 Arabs. It was pretty bad. Thank God they didn't. There was no physical attack, but it was very, very dangerously close. And my faith was a little shaken. But this book really was able to enhance my life. Hi, Stephanie. Good morning. And I want you to know that if you're going through a difficult time right now, we all are. If any one of you is going through a specifically difficult time, this book will change your perspective on reality. It will give you the tools to be able to change the outcome of whatever it is you're going through, whether it's a financial problem, whether it's a medical concern, whether it's fertility or friendship or relationships or health or whatever is your problem. This book will change your perception of reality. If you just tuned in, we're learning The Gates of Trust. It's this book here. It's a 13th century work by Rabbi Rabbeinu Bachaye, written originally in Arabic, translated into English and Hebrew. And this book is the changes our perception of reality. I'm going to get straight into it right now on page 349. If you happen to have the book, if you don't have the book, I did post a link to The Gates of Trust. I'm going to get straight into it. It's about 150, 120 pages. We'll go through it in the next few weeks, every morning. Okay, so let's do this. Having discussed in the preceding gate the obligation to assume the service of God, I think it proper to follow with what is needed to above all things by a servant of God, and that is trust in God. For it is of great benefit in both religious and secular affairs. Among its benefits to him in religious life is tranquility of soul in reliance on God, may he be exalted, as the servant is bound to rely on his master. For if a person does not put his trust in God, he places his trust in what is other than God. I want to just comment on that a moment. We as human beings always trust in something. As much as we kid ourselves that we are self-reliant, as much as we kid ourselves that we are independent, we are not. As human beings, we always believe in something. It humors me when I talk to an atheist and he tries to ridicule my faith. And I always point out to him how even the atheist believes in something. Whether you believe in the United States of America, whether you believe in monogamy, whether you believe in some other value, they always believe in something. A true atheist would believe in nothing, would be an anarchist, total chaos. Yet, everyone believes in something. We all trust in something. We all find our peace of mind in something. It might be your doctor. It might be a lawyer. It might be a politician. It could be your news station where you find your solace. But we all trust in something. What the Rabbeinu Bachai is telling us in the duties of the heart, gates of trust, is that if a person does not put his trust in God, he automatically will place his trust in something other than God. You, as a human being, have to rely on something. Now, I want to explain to you the philosophy of this idea, the notion of this, what this is based on. You see, as human beings, we are essentially reliant on a cause that brought us into effect. This is a philosophical idea. By definition, we come from an origin, from parents. We were born from our parents, and more spiritually, we were created and continue to be created by God. So because by definition, we rely on something that brought us to this point, therefore, we can't help ourselves but to always depend on something else. There is no such thing as a self-reliant human being. Even the biggest billionaire, as Bernie Sanders calls them, billionaires, even they trust in something. They trust in their bank account. They trust in their real estate investments. And it's our dollar bill that states, in God we trust. How incredible, how much foresight our founding fathers put into the establishment of this great United States of America, that on our money, where it hurts, that's where they wrote this incredible language, this incredible affirmation, in God we trust. They don't even say in God we believe. They say in God we trust. Trust is so much more powerful than faith. Faith means, I don't know what's going to happen, but I know that at the end of the day, you know what you're doing. Trust means I know it's going to be good. That's what trust means. Trust is like an insurance policy. I don't care what happens. I know that I'm going to end up with the money. Whether the building burns down or not, I don't know. But I know that I'm going to still have the money. That's trust. That's an insurance policy. I know that God will not abandon me. Everything will be okay. It will be good. That's trust. Faith means it might not work out the way I expect it to, but at the end of the day, I know that God knows what he's doing. That's faith. It's like a safety net. And Mickey's asking, what chapter is the portion that you're reading from? I'm reading from a section of the Gates of Trust called Duties of the Heart called the Gates of Trust. That's what I'm reading from. It's the first section. So what the first is a brilliant notion that this brilliant scholar says, Rabbeinu Bachaye, is that if a person does not trust his God in God, he places his trust in something other than God. And I challenge you to consider with what you trust in. Do you trust in God? Or do you trust in medicine? Do you trust in science? Do you trust in technology? Do you trust in your car? And think of an atheist that you know, and think of what they actually trust in. You'll find they always trust in something. And whoever trusts in something which is other than God, this is the kicker. God removes his providence from him and leaves him in the hands of whoever he trusted. This is a game-changing perspective on reality. One more time. Whoever trusts in what is other than God, God removes his providence from him and leaves him in the hands of whatever he trusted in. I think it was Timon in the Lion King, that classic. Showed it to my kids the other day. Timon in the Lion King, he said, when the world turns its back on you, you turn your back on the world. That's what he tells Simba, the Lion King, who's running away from his monarchy, from his uncle Scar. When the world turns its back on you, you turn your back on the world. That actually is how God treats us. How we treat God is exactly how God treats us. God is a mirror image to us. When we are kind to God, then God is kind to us. When we are generous, God is generous to us. When we are nasty towards God, then God is nasty towards us. It's a mirror image. In fact, it says in Psalms, Hashem Tzilcha, God is your shadow. Just like a shadow doesn't do anything differently to what the person himself does. The shadow does exactly what the person does. If I go like this, then the shadow goes like, oh, there's my shadow. You see him behind me? The shadow, that's brilliant, actually. I didn't know that I had a shadow here behind me. But you see, the shadow is doing exactly what I'm doing. Down, up, left, right. Okay? See, the shadow does exactly what I'm doing. That's what God does. When I trust in God, then God is favorable to me. When I turn my back on God, then God says, okay, so you go ahead and trust in what you believe in. Now, before I get to Rob Berger's tough question over here, I'm going to get that in a moment. I just want to say this. The Purim story, the entire Purim story is based on this principle. You see, what happened was in the Purim story that the Jewish people went to the feast that Mordechai advised them not to go to. They went to the party of Achashverosh, which lasted 6 months and 7 days. And at that feast, they were celebrating the death of the Jewish God. They were celebrating the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem. That's why Achashverosh dressed up in the robes of the high priest. And he desecrated the holy vessels of the temple. Right? How could a Jew attend such a feast? How disgusting, how obnoxious for a Jew to attend such a feast. Don't forget the food was kosher. They justified it by saying, you know, okay, he's celebrating the death of the Jewish God, but at least he invited us. At least the king, the most powerful person in the world, invited us to his party. So we feel welcome. That's great. It's amazing that he invited us to his party. So we have friends in high places. And therefore, they justified their attendance at the party by saying, we don't want to alienate our connection with the person in the White House. We're the most powerful person in the world. At that time, it was in Shushan, in Persia, in Iran. When Iran was the superpower of the whole world, King Ahasuerus ruled over every country in the world from Ethiopia to India. They said, even though he's making fun of our God, nevertheless, we've got friends in the White House. We've got friends in the most powerful person in the world. So God said, okay, you're trusting in him. Let him protect you. And what happened when Ahasuerus was offered a proposal by Haman to wipe out the Jews? He said, okay. Wipe them out, no problem. You want to put your trust in the king of flesh and blood, then you're at his mercy, and then that's exactly what happened. The turnaround of the Purim story was when Esther needed to plead before the king to solicit his favor. What she did is that she took 3 days of fasting. She fasted 3 days before approaching the king. In other words, she recognized, she made sure that she and all the Jewish people of Shushan repaired their relationship with God, so that by the time she approached the king, her allegiance was with God and not with the king. And now they were able to put their trust in God, and therefore God was able to take care of them. So that's the essence of the Purim story. I'm just going to finish this paragraph one more time. For if a person does not put his trust in God, he places his trust in what is other than God. And whoever trusts in what is other than God, God removes his providence from him and leaves him in the hands of whatever he trusted in. He becomes like those of whom it is said, two evils have my people committed. They have forsaken me, a freshwater spring, to hew themselves cisterns, cracked cisterns. Jeremiah. Or Tehillim, Psalms, they exchange the glory for the image of a bull that eats grass. Why would you abandon Almighty God to trust in a person of flesh and blood? During this coronavirus, do you trust in God? Or do you trust in the doctors in Israel to develop a vaccine. If you're trusting in the doctors in Israel, you know what that means? That means you're trusting in a person of flesh and blood. And if you're trusting in a person of flesh and blood, you know that they will throw you under the bus if they can. It's just the nature of human beings. There's no reason for a person to be unconditionally committed to you. Only God Almighty, who is infinitely kind. That's a concept that we can't even relate to as human beings. Infinitely and unconditionally kind. God is almighty, God is just, and God is kind. Always kind, always just. Only God will never abandon you. But if you want to put your trust in a human being, it's like choosing to abandon in the words of Antonella, one of the members of our show, it's like choosing to abandon your five-star glitzy vacation in a Paris hotel to go fish for frogs in Lake Okeechobee. Why would you want to do that? Why would you want to put your trust in a human being that can abandon you at any moment if you could put your trust in God Almighty? And that's what this is about. Yes, God might send his blessing through the vaccine developed by doctors in Israel or by doctors in China or Iran or whatever. Or God might send his salvation by somehow causing the weather to warm up and maybe the virus just automatically dies and we never hear about it again. Or who knows, some other way. I don't know. Maybe somebody realizes that malaria, the malaria pills are perfect for getting rid of coronavirus, and bam, in 2 seconds, everybody's going to take their pills and it'll be done and be gone. Who knows? Who cares how the salvation will come? The point is, our trust is in God. I'm just going to go a little further. Scripture also states in Jeremiah, "Blessed is the man who trusts in God, who makes God his refuge." A quote from Psalms 40, "Blessed is the man who makes God his trust and did not turn to the arrogant or those that stray after falsehood." Another quote from Jeremiah, "Cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his strength while his heart turns away from God. If he relies on his wisdom and ingenuity, his physical strength and his own efforts, he will labor in vain. His strength will fail and his ingenuity will be inadequate to achieve his goal. As it says in scriptures, he traps the clever in his own cunning." Job. Also in Ecclesiastes, "Again, I saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the mighty, nor bread to the wise." This is a beautiful quote. "Nor bread to the wise." Lo lachachamim lechem. Bread does not go to the wise, folks. The rich are not the more intelligent people, right? Don't think that Warren Buffett or Michael Bloomberg or Mark Zuckerberg are such geniuses and that's why they became so rich. Bread does not go to the wise. Right? The race doesn't go to the swift, not the battle to the mighty, nor the bread to the wise. God chooses who wins the race. God chooses who will win the battle. God chooses who will be rich. In fact, some of the richest people in the world are not the sharpest pencils, if you know what I'm saying. The wealth goes to the ones that God chose. Don't trust in people. Don't trust in Warren Buffett or in Berkshire Hathaway. Don't trust in the Dow Jones, okay? Because we see that what's happening. I don't know what the market is doing today. But one thing we know is that you can't trust in any of this stuff. And nobody knows how this works. It all is in the hands of God. "If he relies on his great wealth, it will be taken from him and left to someone else." If you rely on your money, it will be taken from you. As it says in scripture in Job, "He lies down rich and it is not taken away. He opens his eyes and it is gone." In the book of Proverbs, "Do not toil to get wealth of your own understanding. Desist before you can set your eyes on it. It is gone." Don't believe in yourself. Trust in God. The approach of the believer is that he plants seeds in the ground. But when he plants seeds in the ground, he doesn't trust in the ground or trust in the seeds. He prays to God and then he plants seeds in the ground because he knows God wants me to become rich through the growth of my farm. God wants me to become rich through the Dow Jones. God wants me to become rich through my real estate investment. I don't trust my real estate investment. I don't trust the stock market and I don't trust the farming earth. I trust in God knowing that the earth and the stock market and my real estate investments is only a vehicle. It's just a tool, nothing more and nothing less than just a tool through which the blessing comes to me. "At a young age, you will leave him, and at the end, he will be a disgrace." Jeremiah. Another quote from Ecclesiastes, "Or else you will be denied the opportunity of enjoying it, as the wise man King Solomon said, but the Almighty does not give him the power to enjoy it." Now, at this point, I'd like to address Rob's question. So we said so far that trust in God is the key to our blessing. If you trust in God, then God will protect you. If you don't trust in God, you trust in something else, then God will say, okay, you're at the mercy and the whim of whatever it is that you're trusting in. So Rob is asking a question. The philosophy is inviting and admirable, but always breaks down when bringing up the Holocaust. Did the 6 million not have trust? When bad things happen to people, does that mean they did not have trust? So Rob, the question was addressed by the Baal Shem Tov, who lived long before the Holocaust, 300 years ago. And the Baal Shem Tov says that sometimes when God is intent on bringing about a specific bad decree for some inexplicable reason that we obviously don't understand, then God will sometimes deny us the ability to trust in God. He will actually remove from us that key to salvation. He will take away the key to trusting in God, which is the automatic path to achieving positive results. Now that's a powerful concept. And this is how I understand the Holocaust. That during the Holocaust, for whatever reason, God was intent on making the Holocaust happen. I'm not God. I don't know why he did it. My own grandparents and many, many, many members of my family and my people suffered, obviously, and were perished in the Holocaust. Why it happened is not for me to understand, to condone, to justify. I would never want to give a good answer to the Holocaust, because the moment that we had a good answer to the Holocaust, we would become insensitive to it. And therefore avoiding the explanation of why the Holocaust happened, which I wouldn't even dare to try to deal with. I do want to say to you, to your specific question, did the 6 million not have trust? My answer to you is yes. I believe that the 6 million did not have trust, not because they didn't believe in God or didn't trust in God. I'm sure there were many, many, many good Jewish people over there, many strong believers in God. But I do think that God took away from them the ability to trust in God by elevating their anxiety levels to such heights that they simply were not able to trust in God. Now, this is not an easy level to reach, by the way. If you're going through a very fearful time in your life, if you're going facing a court case or facing a medical predicament, your anxiety levels are elevated. It's very, very difficult to find that equilibrium, to be able to exercise a fortress mentality, to shut out all negative energy and to experience true faith and trust in God. It's very, very difficult. It takes a lot of focus. I believe that the people in the Holocaust did not have the ability to trust in God because the anxiety levels were so elevated. I can't imagine being shuffled around from their homes to a ghetto, to a concentration camp and whatever else. I can't imagine how awful that must have been. And maybe they were denied the ability to be able to trust in God because for whatever reason, God had a decree that he wanted to fulfill this Holocaust. And therefore, when bad things happen to people, does that mean that they did not have trust? Yeah, that's exactly what it means. That's exactly what it means, Rob. Whether they did not have trust because they could not have trust because it was taken away from them, as I just explained, or because they didn't have trust because they just didn't have trust. That's how the book, Chovas HaLevavos, The Duties of the Heart, which, by the way, is an all-time, across-the-board, every single Jew classic book. This book is like one of the most fundamental works of all of Jewish history, accepted across the board, everybody. One of the most classic works in the history of the Jewish people. That if you trust in God, you will receive the blessing, the desired outcome. If you don't trust in God, you're putting yourself at peril. So yeah, when bad things happen to people, that's exactly what I'm saying, Rob. That means that those people did not have trust. I hope that you're okay with this and do share your comments over here. What I am telling you right now is that as we stand at this very fearful time, of this anxiety elevated state of period when the whole world is experiencing such fear and anxiety. You know, today I woke up this morning, I said to myself, I'm not going to read all of the WhatsApp and social media messages because it is just like a deafening echo chamber. Everybody giving every which update from around the world and every little projection of what the updates are going to be. They tell us what the update is going to be before the update is. It's crazy, and you can't focus for 5 seconds. I got to tell you, I realized that I was unable to have a fortress mentality yesterday. I couldn't meditate because I'm so inundated with all the fears, and they're going to do this in New York, and they're thinking to do something else in New Jersey and South Africa and some other country and in Israel, and here's a video and here's a message and here's a this and that and the other. I woke up today, I said, you know what? I should get off of WhatsApp. I want to just not look at it because it's so stressful to follow all of these messages, because I need to engage my meditative power of trust, because trust is what's going to bring us the blessing. And if you don't have trust, if you're inundated with the echo chamber of fear and anxiety, you're putting yourself at peril. We have nothing to fear but fear itself. Rob, I hope you're okay with my answer. If not, do let me know. I'm just going to finish this paragraph before we proceed. So I'm continuing. If you have the book, if you don't have the book, I encourage you to buy this book. Go to Amazon and order the book, Duties of the Heart. It's published by Feldheim Publishers. I'm going to post it in the, comments of here. I'm going to look it up quickly. Give me a quick moment. And I would highly encourage you to order this book on Amazon. Get it delivered to your door, because this book, folks, will change your life. Please do order this book. I'm posting it right now. Here, order this book. And I really hope that you will, I just put it in the comments. I really hope that you can order this book, because reading this book will change your life. Can I finish the paragraph over here? So the money that you have, he has it merely as a deposit to keep out of harm's way until it reaches someone who is worthy of it. So God only deposits the money with you to keep it out of harm's way. But if you don't have trust, then God is going to take it away from you and give it to someone else. As it says, but to the sinner, it gives the work of gathering and amassing to hand over to one who is good before God. He prepares it, but the righteous man will wear it, and the innocent man will divide the silver. His wealth will also be the cause of his undoing and the loss of his soul. As it says, there is an evil affliction that I've observed under the sun, wealth reserved for its owner for his misfortune. What an amazing statement by King Solomon of Ecclesiastes. He says his wealth may also be the cause of his undoing. It is an evil affliction, and I've observed it under the sun, wealth reserved for its owner. When you have too much money, you run the risk of trusting in your money. Folks, I want you to stop a moment and think right now. However much money you have in your bank account right now, do you trust in the money? Is that what's giving you serenity, the money that's in your bank account? If it is, you just curse your money. Stop. Raise your eyes higher. Su'uma romei nechem. Raise the horizons of your eyes. Ura'u, and see mi bara eile, who created these. Lift up your eyes higher than the Dow, higher than the Nasdaq, higher than your real estate investments, and see who created this all. And thank God for what God has given you. Raise your horizons higher than the money that you have. Trust not in your money. Trust in God. Because King Solomon says that there is an evil observed under the sun, and wealth reserved for its owner for his misfortune. If you trust in your money, you are setting yourself up for disaster. Don't do it. Trust in God, and that will bring you the salvation that you desperately seek. Look at the comments of here. Mickey, Rabbi, just forwarded a copy of the book to your email in the EPUB format. So Mickey, why don't you forward? Mickey, could you post the book in EPUB format here? Post it right here on this group, so everybody who's studying with us can open the book in the format that you're talking about. Daniel, please forward the email. Very good. Tag Mickey. Either I'm not understanding you, or I have a major problem when you say none of the 6 million have trust in God. Okay, Mickey, let's talk about this. None of the 6 million have trust in God. What's the problem? What's your problem with saying that 6 million Jews do not have trust in God? Do you know how many have trust in God? I mean, seriously, Mickey, I'm just checking your email right now that you sent me to make sure that it's the right one. So you can post it on the group. Gates of Trust, let's see, Mickey. Hold on, don't go away. I think it's loading. I don't know what's going on over here. I don't know what EPUB is, Mickey. I don't know what this EPUB thing is, but definitely it's good. I mean, it looks good, Mickey. Just post it to the group and see what happens. Anyways, what's the problem? Why are you not okay with saying that 6 million have trust in God? How hard it is to have trust in God? I mean, to trust in God means to, like, pick yourself up, remove yourself from reality of the world that surrounds you, not to trust in your army, not to trust in your passports, not to trust in your country. You know, how many German Jews were more German than they were Jewish? I mean, that's not hard to understand. It's the post-Jews, which is the hard one to understand, because those ones were far more religious and far more observant. By the way, not to say that just because they were less observant, they were somehow, God forbid, deserving of the Holocaust. No, I'm not saying that at all. I'm just saying that to trust in God takes tremendous elevation of your mindset. You literally have to remove yourself from this planet and to believe in a higher world. That's not easy. And to believe in, to have trust. And we're going to learn this through the gates of trust. To have trust means to have zero anxiety. Okay? Maybe that explains it. Zero anxiety. I have a hard time saying the 6 million Jews experience zero anxiety. I want to ask you if you have zero anxiety about anything in your life. I know that I struggle with that every single day, with every single problem that I have, and whatever problem I have, for me to raise myself up to a state of perfect trust in God, which means zero anxiety. That is not easy, bro. Not easy. That's what I say. So Nikki uploaded the link. Thank you so much. Dvorah Hanan, their anxiety level is so high that their ability to trust in Hashem was taken away. Exactly, Dvorah Hanan. That's exactly my point. They were so unbelievably anxious, it was impossible for them to trust in God. Okay, good. Anyways, so that's my answer, folks. I'm going to move on to Hayom Yom, if you are okay with me moving on. I know this is very controversial, and that's, we did 1.5 pages today out of 140, 130 pages of the Gates of Trust. This is going to be one heck of a journey. And I'm excited to take this journey with you because you're asking all the right questions. And yes, this is something extraordinary. I'm getting a message here. I wonder if it's from someone who's listening to this radio, to this broadcast. I don't know. I don't think so. Anyway, fine. So, one more comment over here. Error loading, how to fix it. Stephanie, are you saying an error loading the video or an error loading the book, which Mickey published, uploaded? I don't know. Anyways, Mickey, I'm sure you can work it out. You're a tech director. Hopefully you can post it here for people. But folks, I highly encourage you, just buy this book. Buy it on Amazon. It's like $40 or $50. You can buy the large version or the small version. It's a 2-volume set. This book is a book you want to have in your home. You want this book to be sitting on your bookshelf. Trust me, it is well worth the $40 or $50 that it costs. Please buy this book. It will change your life. Okay, good. Anyways, I'm moving on to Yom Yom. Today's Yom Yom, before we do Talmud, is the 23rd of Adar 1. Rabbis and scholars are called the eyes of the community and the heads of the thousands of Israel. And when the head is healthy, the body is then also healthy. Basically, the fish stinks from the head is what it says here today, that the rabbis and scholars are the eyes and the heads of the community. And when the head is healthy, the body is also healthy. What is the message here to all the people? I guess it means that the rabbis and scholars need to be, you know, in the context of what we're learning here, I think I'll tell you what it means. When the rabbis themselves are exhibiting perfect trust in God, I think that trickles down to the people. That's my understanding. When the people... It's much, much easier for the people to find their trust in God when the rabbis and the scholars of the community have perfect trust in God. If God forbid they don't, then I don't know how the people will be able to get it. Moses is a faithful shepherd known as the shepherd of faith. He was the one who shepherds faith to the people. That's the role of a rabbi, is to be a shepherd of faith. And if your faith, if the rabbi's faith is strong, then you can shepherd that faith to the people. So I'm saying to you guys, as you're struggling right now to make sense of this trust concept with the Holocaust, Rob, and Mickey's question, these are very, very good questions. And the fact that you're struggling with them means that you're really listening to what I'm saying. I want to tell you, this is not a quick fix that happens in one day. It's going to grow on you and it's going to take time. And I want to study this with you every single day for the next entire quarantine. We'll do this together. It's going to take time, but hang in there. Keep an open mind. That's the catch here. Mickey, especially you. All right. today's second Hayom Yom for the second Adar. It goes like this. My father, the fifth Rebbe, said to a Rav, to a rabbi who labored in divine service and was an especially diligent scholar. He said to him that a rabbi must always at all times and at every moment that he always must remember at all times and at every moment that he always stands on the threshold between being one of those who bring merit to the public and, God forbid, one of those who cause the public to sin. The threshold between the loftiest of heights and the most abysmal depth. All issues must touch him at the innermost core of his soul, literally because his very soul is at stake. So basically, the fifth Rebbe said to a rabbi who was brilliant in Torah study and divine service. They better watch it, because your divine service is what impacts the people tremendously. Very closely connected to the previous Yom Yom, which is be careful, be mindful. Rabbis are going to really watch it, because if a rabbi messes up, then that's really going to impact his people. I actually saw a horrible, a very painful message from a rabbi who wrote to his community a message which was filled with thoughts of anxiety and fear, and he was really mongering fear to the people. I thought it was very upsetting. I wrote him a letter telling him that this was really a very negative approach to take, and I really hope that we can strengthen our faith, at least through this viral message, this message. By the way, folks, if you could share this video onto your pages, to your friends as well, I think it would be very good if you could share the trust, share the serenity, share the tranquility with your friends. It would help to get the message out. Remember, this virus is infecting people randomly in a negative way. So let us use this Torah study to be able to impact random people in a positive way. Let's fight the virus by sharing positive messages, as opposed to the virus, which is sharing harm and negativity. So if you could share this video to your Facebook pages, that'll be awesome. Helen Alec is asking a question. No, Warren is. But the 6 billion Jews wasn't worldwide, only Europe. Warren, Mickey question still stands with. Warren, I don't understand. Why is Mickey's question still? What's the problem if 6 Jews didn't have trust in God, or 6 million Jews couldn't trust in God? I don't understand. Is it the number of people that is bothering you here? I'm not understanding the question. I'm really not understanding the question. Why are you so having such a hard time saying that the Jews of the Holocaust didn't have trust in God? Why is that? Maybe you could elaborate a little bit more on the question. And Michael, yes, the Hayom Yom is in the Chayenu book and in the app as well. Warren, could you explain this, please? I don't understand what your question is. Mickey, did I answer your question? Please let me know. I don't know. Honestly, I don't understand what the problem is. If you could please let me know what the problem is from your perspective. Why are you having such a hard time saying that 6 million Jews were not able to have trust in God? I just want you to put yourself in their shoes. I mean, think of any Holocaust movie that you've ever seen. Think about little boys and girls being paraded out in the street, and parents being humiliated, and horrible stories of look, turning on a radio and listening to the Führer and the Nazi things outside, screaming and shouting, and the flags unfurled everywhere. I don't understand why you think that it's so unthinkable that they didn't have trust in God. Okay, Mickey, you say, no, I did not. All right. Why did I not answer your question, Mickey? Other than the fact that you're always a contrarian. Other than that, why would you say that I did not answer your question? I need a good explanation as to why, what problem you have with what I said. I'm waiting. Anyways, while I'm waiting, the trust in God is a novel concept, folks. It is not something that comes to us by default. It literally means that you've got to be able to abandon your perception of reality and to say God is in control, even though I don't see it. Even though Hitler is ruling Germany and people are dying and being sent to concentration camps and never being seen or heard from again, I can trust that God is in control. I don't see the problem with why that is so easy. I don't see why you think that's such an easy level to reach. On the contrary, you know what, guys? If you think, Mickey, that that's an easy level to reach, then you know what? Good for you. That means you're a big believer, and that's fantastic. Mickey's comment, problem is included. In the 6 mil were clearly a number of very devout men and women who had absolute trust in God. Mickey, you missed the point that I said. Yes, they were very devout. They were very religious. Some of the 6 million people were very, very religious Jewish men and women, I'm sure. However, what I said earlier was that the Baal Shem Tov said that the Baal Shem Tov was the founder of the Hasidic movement. He said that sometimes God removes the ability to trust in God from people because of a certain decree that he wants to put upon the people. So he removes from us the ability to trust in God. It doesn't have anything to do with how religious you are. doesn't have anything to do with that. It doesn't mean that they were not religious. It doesn't mean that the rabbis weren't really as holy as they looked like. That's not what it means. When God takes away the ability to trust in God, it means that they were religious. I'm sure they were laying tefillin every day. They were lighting Shabbos candles. They were studying Torah. They were doing a lot of mitzvahs. They were doing whatever they needed to do. But the ability to trust in God, that peace of mind, that sense of tranquility was removed from them. God did not allow them to do that. So I think that's the problem, your fundamental misunderstanding of what I'm saying. I'm not saying that they were not religious. Don't get me wrong here. I'm not saying that they were somehow deserving of being suffering in the Holocaust. God forbid, heaven help me from saying such an awful and obnoxious thing. What I'm saying is that during the Holocaust and when bad things happen, it is very likely that the people that went through the hard times were not trusting in God. When you say trusting in God, you have to understand what that means. Trusting blindly in God to the point of zero anxiety, not to the point of 1% anxiety or 0.5% anxiety, but to the point of zero anxiety. And that is such a lofty level, which I don't think many of us are able to reach very easily. I think it takes tremendous work and focus. And if you don't understand it, then I think it's going to take time to build up the notion of what trusting God really means. Remember, we only did the first page and a half of 130 pages of The Gates of Trust. So hold your horses. Don't throw the Holocaust question at this machine to be able to say, well, this is not any more relevant. I don't want to listen to this anymore because of the Holocaust. And you know what? Even if you still have a question, we have a saying in Yiddish, von a kasha starb man nicht. Nobody died from a question. You have a question? Good. That doesn't mean you have to throw out the baby with the bathwater. It doesn't mean you have to say that it's all nonsense because I have a question. You have a question? Okay. So the question will get an answer sooner, maybe later, maybe it'll take time. Maybe you need to educate yourself more to the understanding of the idea before you can come to properly understand the answer. Hold the question. Okay, it's a question. It doesn't mean that the idea is not an idea because the question is a question. And with that, folks, I'm going to move on into Talmud. Hey, Chana, is there a way to change? Is it even possible? I don't understand what you're talking about. What are you asking, Chana? Is there a way to change what? To change that. I'm not sure what you're talking about, Chana. If you please elaborate, I'd appreciate it. Sandy Gladding, good morning and welcome to Souls on Fire. We are learning Souls on Fire. Definitely, guys, I think it's a great debate. For me to be sitting here alone, to be surrounded by 18 of my dearest friends and to be having this debate is awesome. Souls on Fire. I think we're definitely getting into it. Rob, I hope I haven't said anything offensive, by the way, because you've been very quiet. Marty, good to hear from you. Perhaps to permit an enhanced dialogue we have each morning pre-virus, we should utilize a FaceTime group so we can converse together. This is not excluding the use of Facebook. So to allow an enhanced dialogue that we have each morning, we should utilize a FaceTime group so that we can converse together. This is not excluding the use of Facebook. Marty, we can use an app called Zoom. There's an app called Zoom. The ladies are using it very, very well, very efficiently. We could technically do that too. I wouldn't mind if you would like to set such a thing up to organize a group. I think that would be a great idea. Chana's asking to have that kind of faith. Is there a way to change that? Is it even possible to have that kind of faith? I think Hannah's question is, if God removed our ability to have that kind of trust, then can you change that? I believe not. If God decreed that we cannot have that kind of trust because he wants to make a certain bad decree happen, I don't think we can change that. It's like a black cloud that descends upon us and we just can't see. We just don't have the ability to have that trust. I mean, you know what? Maybe you can. I don't know. I don't know. We'll find out in the gates of trust. It's a great question. Warren Beck here. Why would so many Jews in one part of the world not have trust in God? There were many Jews around the world who didn't have trust in God. Were they punished? Warren, if I was God, I'd probably have the answer to that question. I'm not. So I don't know why God decided that many Jews in that one section of the world should suffer. I have no idea why God would do that. In fact, I have no idea why God does anything, but I will tell you one quick story from the Alter Rebbe, the founder of the Chabad, the author of the Tanya. The Alter Rebbe was sitting once surrounded by his closest friends. They were called the Chevra Kadisha. Today, the Chevra Kadisha is the Holy Burial Society. But in those days, the Chevra Kadisha was the holy society. These were the students of the Magid of Mezrich, the successor of the Baal Shem Tov. These were brilliant, holy mystics. They were saints. And they were sitting around and they were chatting. They were having a farbrengen. And the topic of the farbrengen was, what would you do if you were God? So one of them said, if I was God, I would make sure that there was no illness whatsoever in the world. Another one said, if I was God, I'd make sure that there'd be no poverty and hunger in the world. Another one said, if I was God, I'd make sure there's no suffering. Another one said, there'd be no loneliness, there'd be no infertility, there'd be no fighting. Each one came up with a various idea about what they would do if they were God. And then came the turn of the Alter Rebbe. And the Alter Rebbe, the founder of Chabad, remember, Chabad is logic. Different to the other Hasidic groups, which are more emotionally based, the Alter Rebbe founded a philosophy which was intellectually based. That's the Chabad movement. Chabad means logic. It's a rational approach to faith. The Alter Rebbe said, if I were God, and this is deep, folks. Warren, hold your horses here. If I were God, says the Alter Rebbe, I would do things exactly the way that God did it. Why? I would do things exactly the way that God did it. What Alter Rebbe was saying, all of you folks were saying how you would behave if God was you. Not if you were God. If God was you, this is how you would do things. But if I were God, then I would understand what God understands. I would see what God sees. And therefore, I would do things exactly as God does them. Because I am not here to doubt God's wisdom or judgment. Who are we to doubt God's judgment? It's like the chess piece who is shouting at the chess player, how dare you put me in the line of fire? What does the chess piece know and understand that's going on in the mind of the chess master? That's kind of like what we are, criticizing God. So that's the answer to the question. Anyways, folks, let's go a little further. We're doing some Talmud. We're moving on to the book of Inyaka. Very controversial debate, and I love it. I love the fact that we're arguing here. I love the fact that I'm able to really push you to move out of your comfort zones with this whole Holocaust, trusting, and applying it to coronavirus. Folks, if I'm going to leave you today with one thought, it's let trust in God reign supreme. Don't listen to the medical doctors. Don't listen to the prophets of gloom and doom. Everything will be good. Trust in God. Do take medical precaution. Do whatever the doctors tell you to do. Take the medications and quarantine and do whatever you have to do. But don't trust in the doctors. Trust in God. The doctor is merely an agent, an emissary, a messenger to deliver the healing. But the blessing does not come from the doctor. The blessing comes from God. It only comes through the doctor. Quick story here is the kid who needed a bicycle. So he decided to write a letter to God. God, please send me $100. I need to buy a bicycle. And on the envelope, he puts G-O-D and he puts it in the mail. The mailman is humored by this letter, which is addressed to God, no address. So what does he do? He forwards it to the White House. He sends it to the White House. I guess that the White House press secretary receives it and he sees it. He says, you know what? A letter to God, I'll give it to President Trump. I'm sure he'll enjoy that. So President Trump sees it. A letter to God. The kid wants a bicycle. He tells the press secretary, give the kid $10. He puts $10 in an envelope and he sends it on White House stationery, sends it back to the kid. The kid is overjoyed a few days later when he receives a letter from the White House with a $10 bill, and he proceeds to write his thank you letter to God. He says, dear God, thank you for responding to my letter. I am so touched. I'm a believer. I love you, God. But please, God, next time, don't send it through Washington. Those jerks deducted 90%. The message, folks, is that the White House is not the source of our blessing. It is only the conduit of our protection. Don't trust in God. Sorry, don't trust in the president. Don't trust in the White House. Don't trust in the Congress or the Senate. In God we trust. Everyone else pays cash. Okay, so with this, folks, we're going to move on. Oh, Craig says God isn't real. Nice. I don't know who Craig is, but God isn't real. Okay, we have a heckler. This is great. A heckler on Facebook Live. Craig says God isn't real. Okay, Craig. Neither is Steve Jobs, by the way. You know, Steve Jobs does not exist because this phone, I found it when I was cooking dinner last night, just jumped out of the oven and it came in with all my contacts. Steve Jobs is not real. Apple is not real. This is self-created. Just like God is not real. Craig, why are you so... Why are you such a heckler, bro? What's bothering you, man? Where are you from? Tell us a little bit about yourself. Tell us where you're from and why you don't believe in God. It would be fascinating to have that chat with you.